How big is God's heart? God's heart is too big to be contained in any one person's life, yet it is big enough for a whole city. God's heart is big enough for a city full of hurt, despair, and pain. In the Bible, there's a book that is only 4 chapters long, called Jonah. The book of Jonah tells the story of a prophet named Jonah, who was sent to a broken city called Nineveh. The biblical story of Jonah isn't even about Jonah. It's about God's heart for a city. A city long held under the shadow of darkness. A city scarred by brokenness. And a city besieged by hopelessness. A city much like our own. God responded to a city like this by raising up, calling forth, and sending out a man named Jonah. In this series, we will take a look at the story of Jonah and encounter God's heart to reach a city in need of God's hope. Like Jonah, each of us has a decision to make, to run to God's call or to run away.
Let me welcome everybody to week number 1 of our brand new series titled Runaway. I also want to welcome those of you joining us today from the loft. We're so glad to have you guys with us. Also, those of you around the world tuning in, thank you so much for being with us. So how big is God's heart? Because for a lot of people, it's like, you know, God's heart is big enough for me. We don't realize that God's heart is way too big to be contained in any one person's life. God's heart is big enough for anyone, no matter who you are, where you are, what's been done to you, or what's been done by you. But God's heart is also too big to be contained in our life. God's heart is big enough for everyone. And so in our study through this book in the Bible called Jonah, we're going to learn all about God's heart. That God's heart is big enough even for a city, a broken city, a dark city, a damaged city. And so our goal in this series is to encounter the heart of God, not just for us as individuals, but beyond, even for our own city. So today, I want to talk with you about the terrible promise that you can't outrun God. You can't outrun God. If you have a Bible, turn to Jonah chapter 1. That's where we're going to begin today. We'll be in the Old Testament. It's the book of Jonah. The last 12 books in the Old Testament are the minor prophets. Jonah's right there. If you're not sure where Jonah is, just elbow your neighbor. They would love to show you where Jonah is at. That's where we're going to begin today. If you don't have a Bible, don't worry. We'll have everything up on the screen so we can move through the message together. I do want to encourage you to take some notes. So if you like, in the seat back in front of you is a piece of paper. You can take that for notes. Or you can turn on your smartphone. If you have the YouVersion Bible app, look for the live event Colonial Church. You should see our notes in there as we begin this study in the book of Jonah titled Runaway. As we begin, I'm curious, how many of you, by show of hands, know someone personally who has actually run away from home? Can I see your hands? Anybody know anybody who's ever done that? The first time I ran away from home, I was 4 years old. 4 years old. I was with my parents, and they weren't divorced yet, and it was like at the end of an evening, it was right at dusk, and we were heading to the grocery store, everybody piled in the car, and I didn't want to go. I'm like, I don't want to go. And so we're piled in the car, and we're heading down the road, and I'm like, I don't want to go, I want to run away. Now, I don't know where I got the idea. I don't even know where I heard it. I was only 4 years old. But I said, I want to run away. And my dad said, oh, you want to run away, huh? So he pulled over, and he opened the door. And he said, get out. I said, okay. So I got out, 4 years old. They closed the door, and off he drove. Oh, yeah. And about 30 seconds later, you know, the sun went down, and it was completely dark. And I'm like, this isn't at all what I expected. Now, we were at a shopping area that was circular. So what they did is they just drove around the block and came back and picked me up like 2 minutes later. By the time they picked me up, I was totally okay with going to the store. The second time I ran away from home, I was 14 years old. At the age of 14, I was tired of school, tired of homework, teachers, hassles. I'm like, man, I'm running away. So I ran away. The only mistake I made, it was winter time, and it was freezing cold everywhere in Chicago suburbs. I run away, and I'm cold, and I'm hungry. I made it about a week, and then finally I came back home, where it was warm, where we had food. Somebody once said that running away will never solve your problems, unless, of course, your problem is that you're overweight. Then maybe you need to run away. Maybe running away is the right thing for you. I have a confession to make. In 1998, 8 years into following Christ, a totally radical conversion into a relationship from an unchurched person to a follower of Jesus, 8 years into this thing, I was about 7 years in at this one particular church where I was mentored by the senior pastor. He encouraged me to go to Bible college and all of this stuff. And I was a volunteer ministry leader, I was a Bible study teacher, and I was a missionary to our city. I was a paid, sponsored missionary. I just saved all the money and gave it all back. But I was a missionary to our city. And at the end of this seven-year period, the church put it all together and they made an offer to me to invite me to my first ever full-time pastoral role. And I declined. Not only did I decline, I had an announcement to make. So as my mentors telling me, hey, we put this together, we want you to be our pastor of evangelism and mission, I'm like, hey, no thanks. Not only am I not gonna take this offer that for years we've both been brewing over and dreaming about, I'm actually relocating. We're moving. I'm moving to Iowa. Took my wife and my family, and we moved to Des Moines, Iowa, where I decided to continue my management career, to pursue the management career that I had built for so long. My mentor looked me in the face. He said, Jim, I do not believe this is the will of God for you. To which I replied, we'll see. 2 years later, two relocations later, I was sitting in our home in Denver, Colorado, wondering how we ended up where we ended up. Like, we were fighting all the time. We were cussing. We were smoking. It's like our life, like, we were just, what happened? How did we end up here? It was there that I made a discovery, and here's the discovery, that my decision to avoid responsibility with God was actually a decision to run away from God. The decision to avoid responsibility with God was a decision to run away from God. I learned some lessons. There's good news and there's bad news in this lesson. Let me give you the bad news first. Here's the bad news. Here's what I learned. I learned that I can always run away from God. Let me give you the good news. The bad news is I can always run away from God. Here's the good news. You can never get away from God. If you're taking notes, here's our big idea for today. I want you to write this down. Here's the thought we're going to be working with. Here it is. God meets runaways wherever they've ended up. God meets runaways like me and maybe like you wherever they have ended up. Let me ask you a question here today. I mean, if we could just be honest before God, how do you see yourself? Like, how do you see yourself? Because I think for many of us, some of us see ourselves as a success. You know, like, you know what? I'm self-sufficient. I got a decent job, and my relationships are intact. And we see ourselves, you know, I'm a success, self-sufficient. Others of us here see ourselves as a mess, self-destructive. My jobs, I don't have them for long. I don't know how to handle money very well. My relationships are kind of broken. And I think some see ourselves as a success, some see ourselves as a mess. Some self-sufficient, some maybe self-destructive. I think most of us are somewhere in the middle. Here's a question. How does God see you? Scripture says that God looks at the heart. He sees beyond everything. He sees to the depths. How does God see you? Here's what I've come to discover, and I hope this is a discovery we can make together in this series. How does God see you? God sees you when he looks past all the stuff he sees. He sees a fugitive. A fugitive. What's a fugitive? Well, here's a definition. The Cambridge Dictionary defines a fugitive, quote, a person who is running away or hiding. Does that sound familiar to anybody? A person who's running away or hiding. A fugitive. Now, some facts I want to get on the table as we begin today. Fact number one, according to Scripture, Genesis 3:8, ever since the fall of humanity into sin, every human being is running away and hiding from God in some way, shape, or form. It is our natural tendency to run away from God and to hide. We all have the natural born tendency. part of our fallen humanness. This takes me to fact number two. All of us at present have ended up somewhere. Can I ask you where you've ended up? Like, if today's where you are, where have you ended up? Some of us have ended up alone and isolated. Some of us have ended up addicted, hooked, can't stop. Some of us have ended up embittered. Some of us have ended up frustrated. Where have you ended up? Because all of us run and hide, and we all end up somewhere. It was Charles Spurgeon at the end of the 19th century, famous preacher, said this, quote, "Men may change their churches and only change their refuge of lies." Where have you ended up? We all run away from God and hide to some extent. We all end up somewhere. Here's the third fact I want to put in front of you. Here it is. Here it is. There is no refuge from God. There is only refuge in God. So how do I find that? I mean, I'd love to find that place where I can find refuge in God. Well, that's what we're going to learn today in Jonah chapter 1. Before we jump in, let me just give some background on this book. Jonah is one of the 12 minor prophets at the end of the Old Testament. It ends with 12 little books in a row. They're called the minor prophets, not because they weren't important, because their letters are short. It's the 12 last books of the Old Testament. They're minor prophets, Hosea through Malachi. They appear in somewhat chronological order. Jonah is one of them. Yeah, Jonah is a man from a town called Gath-Hepher, which is in northern Israel, 15 miles west of the Sea of Galilee. According to 2 Kings 14:25, he was a successful leader who helped the nation and the people of God of Israel to become successful. He proclaimed the word of God at around 800 to 750 BC. That's when he spoke God's word. He was the first prophet who was ever given a missionary call from God to go proclaim God's word face to face to a foreign people. All the other prophets like wrote and sent letters. Jonah was called face to face to go to a foreign place. And so instead of going, he ran like so many of us. God gave him a hard thing to do, and he turned and he ran the other way. Jonah became kind of a forgotten prophet. In the New Testament, John chapter 7, verse 52, the religious leaders are arguing over who is Jesus, and they're like, "You can't be a prophet. No prophet ever came from Galilee." Problem, Jonah was a prophet who came from Galilee. He became a forgettable prophet because of his story runs from God. There's no hero story there. He became a forgotten prophet. And so in this book of Jonah, we're going to see it's not about Jonah. It's all about God. And in this little book, we're going to see, anybody who has a Bible in front of them with Jonah, you got two pages. You didn't even turn a page. And so much of God's heart is revealed and exposed to us right there. It's with God's heart for a runaway guy like Jonah and like us. God's heart for runaway people. God's heart even for a runaway city like our own. So today, we're in Jonah chapter 1, and we're just going to read. We're going to read the whole chapter. Chapter 1, verses 1 through 17. We're going to put them up on the screen. We're going to read Jonah 1, 1 through 17. Let's get the whole thing. Here it is. Jonah 1, verse 1 says, "Now the word of the Lord came to Jonah the son of Amittai, saying, 'Arise, go to Nineveh, that great city, and call out against it, for their evil has come up before me.' But Jonah rose to flee to Tarshish from the presence of the Lord. He went down to Joppa and found a ship going to Tarshish. So he paid the fare and went down into it to go with them to Tarshish away from the presence of the Lord. But the Lord hurled a great wind upon the sea, and there was a mighty tempest on the sea, so that the ship threatened to break up. Then the mariners were afraid, and each cried out to his God, and they hurled the cargo that was in the ship into the sea to lighten it for them. But Jonah had gone down into the inner part of the ship and had laid down and was fast asleep. So the captain came and said to him, 'What do you mean, you sleeper? Arise, call out to your God. Perhaps the God will give a thought to us that we may not perish.' And they said to one another, 'Come, let us cast lots that we may know on whose account this evil has come upon us.' So they cast lots, and the lot fell on Jonah. Then they said to him, 'Tell us, on whose account this evil has come upon us. What is your occupation? Where did you come from? What is your country? And of what people are you?' And he said to them, 'I am a Hebrew, and I fear the Lord, the God of heaven, who made the sea and the dry land.' Then the men were exceedingly afraid and said to him, 'What is this that you have done?' For the men knew that he was fleeing from the presence of the Lord, because he had told them. Then they said to him, What shall we do to you that the sea may quiet down for us? For the sea grew more and more tempestuous. He said to them, pick me up and hurl me into the sea, that the sea will quiet down for you. For I know that it is because of me that this great tempest has come upon you. Nevertheless, the men rowed hard to get back to dry land, but they could not, for the sea grew more and more tempestuous against them. Therefore, they called out to the Lord, O Lord, let us not perish for this man's life, and lay not on us innocent blood, for you, O Lord, have done as it pleased you. So they picked up Jonah and hurled him into the sea, and the sea ceased from its raging. Then the men feared the Lord exceedingly, and they offered a sacrifice to the Lord and made vows. And the Lord appointed a great fish to swallow up Jonah, and Jonah was in the belly of the fish 3 days and three nights. What an incredible story. And this is a story of a man who runs from God. What does it mean to run from God? Well, running from God involves a few simple things. We're going to look at these together. If you're taking notes, you can write this down. Running from God involves, number one, the call of God. First of all, it involves the call of God. I'm curious, by show of hands, how many of you have ever put coins in a vending machine, but you could tell by the sound that they didn't go all the way down? Can you see your hand? So what do you do then, right? You're like, you put your coins in, it goes, and you're like, that didn't sound right. What do? You hit the machine. You don't tap the machine. You hit the machine. You pound the machine. You rock the machine until you hear the coins go all the way down. And once they go all the way down, you go, ah, they made it. Newsflash, my friends, this is exactly how God deals with us. Truth about God is like coins in a machine. According to Romans chapter 1, every single one of us has some idea of some kind of truth about God. Every single one of us. But that truth never really makes it deep down inside of us, the place from which we live and do life and make decisions. And so God comes along and he rattles the machine and he pounds on it to try to get the truth to go deep. And what we see in this story of Jonah, we will see that God will do whatever it takes to get his truth to go deep down into our lives. We're in Jonah chapter 1. Look at verses 1 and 2. It says, now the word of the Lord came to Jonah, the son of Amittai, saying, arise, go to Nineveh, that great city, and call out against it, for their evil has come up before me. Notice that phrase in verse 1 there, the word of the Lord. The word of the Lord came to Jonah. This whole phrase, the word of the Lord, occurs three times in Jonah, right here in chapter 1, verse 1, then in chapter 3, verse 1, then in chapter 3, verse 3. What's going on? God repeatedly calls out to Jonah, like he does for all runaways. He will repeatedly call out to you to try to get your attention. So God repeatedly calls out. By show of hands, how many of you are parents? Can I see your hands? Parents, when you repeat yourself to your children, you repeat yourself because you like the sound of your voice, because you have something important for them to do. It's because you have something important for them to do. And God calls out to Jonah repeatedly because he has something he wants Jonah to do. Now, here's the reality. The thing that God has for Jonah to do for Jonah is irrational. The thing that God is calling for Jonah to do is unreasonable. The thing that God is calling Jonah to do is painful. God, my friends, will give you and I, us, he will give us a tough call where he wants us to do something, and it will seem to you irrational. It will seem to you unreasonable. It will seem even to you as something very painful. In other words, there's a tough assignment. What was the assignment? Well, notice in verse 2, he says, arise, go to Nineveh. Everyone say Nineveh. Nineveh. He says, arise and go to, what's Nineveh? Nineveh is only the biggest, the baddest, the meanest city in the ancient world at that time. It's located right along the Tigris River on the east bank in northern Iraq, opposite the modern town of Mosul. So what you have is you have Jonah's, let's say Jonah's right here. And so Nineveh is 500 miles northeast of Jonah. And God's calling him to go to Nineveh, 500 miles away. Nineveh was a big city. Archaeologists have discovered that the perimeter of the city was 60 miles around. The the walls that protected the inner city were 7.5 miles around. It's a big city. Classical historians refer to Nineveh as the largest city in the ancient world, 600,000 residents in the later millennium before Christ, about 800 BC. It's a big city, but it's also a bad city. Archaeologists have done a lot of study on Nineveh and Assyrian Empire, and the Assyrians were bad dudes, man. Here's what the archaeologists have found. The Assyrians would go take over another people, and no one was more brutal to the people they vanquished than the Assyrians. No one. Archaeologists have proof of tearing off of lips and limbs. The Assyrians were the first army who would love to like conquer a people and then chain everyone together with hooks through the jaw and make a string of people and lead them away from their homeland and then populate their homeland with their own people. They were brutal. The Assyrians would flay people. And if they would flay you, they would take a dead body of someone that had rigor mortis and strap them onto your body. So you'd have to carry a dead body on this long death march. They were brutal people. As a message to those they vanquished, they would leave piles of skulls everywhere. The Assyrians were brutal. They were bad dudes. And later on, the prophet Nahum, in his minor prophet little book, Nahum calls Nineveh a bloody city. Nahum 3:1 calls it a city of lies, fraud, and cruelty. Nahum 3:19. Now here's the point. Here's the point. It was to such a city. It was to such a people that God directed his loving concern by calling and sending Jonah to go to Nineveh and preach sin and preach grace. Why would God do this? Why would God call Jonah to do this? And Jonah's like, well, why? Well, because God's heart is big. God's heart is just bigger than his people. His heart is big enough for all people, even bad people. God has a heart, not just for his nation of Israel, but for all nations. Psalm 96, verse 10 says, say to the nations, God reigns. Psalm 18:49, I will praise you among the nations. 1 Chronicles 16:23, declare his glory among the nations. God calls Jonah, raises him up to send him out to go preach grace, sin and grace. Judgment and forgiveness to the Ninevites. Here's the problem. Nineveh was Israel's oppressor. They were bullies. They did a lot of damage. And Jonah knew this. And Jonah was bitter. And he was resentful. And he wasn't going to do it. God gave Jonah a tough call. Just like he's going to give you and me a tough call. To rise up, to go, and to bring the message of sin and grace to people that you prefer not to. People who have hurt you. People who have done evil against you. People that have returned your good for evil. Tough call. Tough calls require maturity. Let me ask you a question. How would you define maturity? Yes, Christians, how would you define maturity? Many Christians define spiritual maturity in terms of how long you've been around religious people. Longer you've been around, more mature. Or maybe religious understanding. Like the more Bible you know, the more scripture you can talk, then that's maturity for many. In his amazing little book, which I believe every Christian should read, so here's your homework. Look this up. It's a book from Henry Nouwen called In the Name of Jesus. It's a dinky little book, 100 pages. He compares the three temptations of Jesus with the three restorations of Peter. It's a brilliant book, one of my favorite books. And in this book, Henry Nouwen describes Jesus' interaction with Peter, and he defines maturity this way. He says, quote, Jesus has a different vision of maturity. For Jesus, maturity is the ability and the willingness to be led where you would rather not go. Do I have maturity? Do you have maturity? I don't know. How able, how willing are you to let God lead you to a place you'd rather not go? That's maturity. Running from God involves, number one, the call of God. But if you're taking notes, you can write this down. Number two, running from God involves the decision to run. The decision to run. I have a question. What's the greatest ability like that a person possesses? Like a human being, what's the greatest? It's like, is it the ability to procreate and reproduce life? Because that's pretty awesome. Is it the ability to murder and to take a life? Because that's pretty awesome too. What's the greatest ability that a person has? Here's what I think it is. I think it's the ability to decide. The capacity to choose. Because all that you and I will ever do is based on our ability to choose. And while I was sitting there in Denver, Colorado, if I could be perfectly honest with you, it occurred to me, when I was like, how did I end up here? It occurred to me that my destination was the result of my decisions, no one else's. And as we're going to see with Jonah, our choices take us places. So let me ask you, where are you right now? Where have you ended up? How did you get there? Your choices have led you to where you are today. They've led me to where I am today. As we're going to see with Jonah, choices take us places. We're in Jonah chapter 1, those are verse 3. It says, but Jonah rose to flee to Tarshish from the presence of the Lord. And he went down to Joppa and he found a ship going to Tarshish. So he paid the fare and went down into it to go with them to Tarshish away from the presence of the Lord. Notice that word flee in verse 3 right there. But Jonah rose to flee. In Hebrew, flee is barak. It means to withdraw, to run away, to escape. Jonah decided, made a decision to withdraw, to run away, and to escape. From what? Well, text tells us, from the presence of the Lord. In fact, it says it three times in verses 2 and 3. From the presence of the Lord, from the presence of the Lord, from the presence of the Lord. In Hebrew, it does not read from the presence of the Lord. The Hebrew literally reads from the face of the Lord. The face of God is a figure of speech in the Bible that refers to intimacy and closeness with God. Jonah was making a choice to run away from God relationally, not spatially. You know, God's omnipresent. You can't run from God. You know, Psalm 139, verse 7, where can I go to flee from your spirit? If I go to heaven, you're there. If I go to the grave, you're there. I can't. God's like Freddy Krueger in Nightmare on Elm Street. Wherever you go, he's already there. So it's not like Jonah fled spatially. He fled relationally. He turned away. And he ran away. Where did he go? Well, he took a first-class ticket that he paid for to a place called Not Nineveh. Where are you going, Jonah? Not Nineveh. That's for sure. I'll tell you right now. Verse 3 tells us, it says that he took a ship to Tarshish. In fact, it says it three times, to Tarshish, to Tarshish, to Tarshish. Now, the reality was, think of it this way, this is mind-blowing. Here's Jonah. Here's Nineveh, 500 miles to the northeast. Where's Tarshish? Tarshish, if you drew a line from where Nineveh was, or from where Jonah was at, is literally a straight line 2,000 miles in the opposite direction. It's off the coast of west of Spain. It's just in the known world that Jonah lived in. That was the end of the world. It was the farthest possible place in the opposite direction. That's where Jonah went. Tarshish. Mentioned three times to emphasize Jonah made a decision. Jonah made a decision. Jonah made a decision. What was the decision? To run from God. Ah, and therein lies the essence of sin. Sin is running away from God. That's it. Therein lies the essence of sin, running away from God. Newsflash, nobody falls away from God. We run away from God one decision at a time. Where do we run to? Tarshish. Where's Tarshish? Tarshish is just that place where you can go run and hide. That's all. It's just a hiding place. So let me ask you, do you know your own heart? Like, can we be honest? Do you really know your own heart? How do you run and hide from God? We all have our strategies. Have you ever thought about yours? How do you run? How do you hide? Have you ever thought about it? How did Jonah run? Well, it says Jonah found a ship. Here you go. There'll always be a ship. We're good at finding ships. You and I, we are great at finding ships going the other way. We're great at finding a ship away to go hide. Let me ask you, what's your ship? What's your ship? Because the truth is, there's some of you here today, your ship is your career. You are hiding from God in a career. You're spending your whole life trying to make some money, get some titles, get some significance, whatever. You're hiding from God in a ship called your career. There are others of you, you're hiding from God in a ship called relationships. Whether it's bed to bed or friend to friend, you're bouncing, you're trying to get from human beings what only God can give. You're hiding from God in your relationship. There's some of us here today, your ship is it's addiction. It's addiction. You're trying to numb the pain of life through anesthetizing behavior. Whatever it takes to numb the loneliness, the emptiness, the futility, whatever it takes. We all have a ship. Here's the problem, though. We don't connect the idea with our ship, with running from God, with the destruction that it's going to bring. We can never make the connection. One wise man said it this way. He said, quote, sin would have fewer takers if its consequences occurred immediately. But they don't. Jonah ran away. He got on a ship. He hid in the ship. And what happened? The result was a storm of consequences, not just into his lives, but in the lives of all those that were around him on that ship. In fact, they confronted him. Let's look at the confrontation, verses 9 and 10. They confronted Jonah, and he responds. It says, and he said to them, verse 9, I am a Hebrew. I fear the Lord, the God of heaven, who made the sea and the dry land. Then the men were exceedingly afraid and said to him, what is this that you have done? For the men knew that he was fleeing from the presence of the Lord because he had told them. Notice that in verse 9, the words, the Lord, the God of heaven. What's going on here? Just listen to Jonah's talk. Listen to what's coming out of his mouth. What can you deduce about Jonah from his words? Jonah's religious. Jonah's been serving God for a long time, and Jonah's running away from God. How many people does that sound like? I'm religious. I've been doing this religious thing a long time, and I'm running away from God. And I'm bringing junk into your life because I'm running away from God. This is what we see with Jonah. Religious, yet a runaway. That's interesting. I look at these words from Jonah. You know what I see? I see a guy who can explain truth about God, but he's never experienced the grace of God. I see a guy who knows information about God, but he does not know what it means to be transformed by God. I see a guy like I see so many creepy Christians and weird religious people. They know all the stuff, the ideas, the words, but their lives don't bear the mark. There's an old hymn. It goes this way. Sin takes you farther than you wanted to go, keeps you longer than you intended to stay, and costs you more than you can afford to pay. The truth is, my friends, the first step in any relationship to God is to admit that you have run away and that your heart is a heart that wants to run away. That's the first step. And God meets runaways wherever they've ended up. Running away from God, first of all, involves the call of God. Number two, it involves a decision to run. And number three, running from God involves the pursuit of God. The pursuit of God. By show of hands, how many of you have raised children in your home? Can you see how you raise children in your home? Here's a question I have for you. Those of you who have raised children, the rest of you have it, you don't get to say anything. You didn't earn the right. How do children learn? Children learn by experience. Anyone who's ever raised a child knows. How does a kid learn how to talk? By experience. You talk to them, they talk back. We experience language together, and then they learn language. How do children learn how to read? Through experience. How do they learn how to write? Through experience. They learn everything they need to learn to become a human being by experience. We learn by experience. As a kid, I learned a lot of things by experience. For example, when I was a kid, I learned by experience that the reason I have a middle name is so that I could figure out when I was in trouble. I learned that by experience. Every time I heard my middle name, usually followed with a spanking. So I started to connect. When I hear my middle name, run the other way. I learned by experience. As a kid, I learned by experience that boys and girls are different. That girls, not only do they not, that girls don't hit as hard as a guy, guys hit harder than girls. But here's what I learned. Girls hit lower than guys. I learned that by experience. I can hit harder, but they will hit lower. Hey, figure that out. Learn by experience. I learned that my pinky toe is actually a device used for locating furniture in a dark room. I learned this by experience. Life's essential truths, my friends, can only be learned by experience. And from Jonah's experience with God, we see that God uses two experiences to teach all runaways, two of them. And you can write them down. They're not on your notes. The verses are, but they're not. You can write these down. First of all, here's one. God uses great storms. God uses great storms. He's in verse 4. It says, but the Lord hurled a great wind upon the sea, and there was a mighty tempest on the sea, so that the ship threatened to break up. Now, I want you to notice in verse 4, the first three words, it says, but the Lord. But the Lord. Now, if sin is running away from God, then grace is God's pursuit after those who run away. It's God's effort to pursue those of us who run away. How did God pursue him? Well, that's where the bad news comes in. God sent a storm. Here's what you need to understand. The storm was not punishment. That storm in your life is not punishment from an angry God. That storm in your life is an intervention from a loving God who sees your self-destructive behavior, and he knows where you're going, and he loves you too much, he will send a storm to intervene. Storms are not punishments. Storms are interventions. So here's a question. How is God disrupting your plans right now in life? What is God frustrating in your life? He ain't letting happen right now. What storms is God allowing? What interceptions and interventions does God seem to be bringing? It was Charles Haddon Spurgeon, again, a 19th century preacher, said this way, quote, God will not allow his children to sin successfully. He will frustrate you and me. And Jonah ran from God. He ran into a storm, and he ended up getting thrown overboard, dumped in the water, like many of us. So we see that God uses great storms in verse 4, but second thing I want to show you is that God uses dark places. God uses dark places. Yeah, in verse 17, if you can skim to the end of the chapter, verse 17 says this, and the Lord appointed a great fish to swallow up Jonah, and Jonah was in the belly of the fish for 3 days and three nights. Now, here's the weird thing. You can see there in verse 17, it begins, and the Lord. The weird thing is in Hebrew, it's exactly the same as verse 4, but the Lord. It's not and the Lord, it's but the Lord. Why is that important? Because there's more grace. Jonah runs away, but the Lord uses a great storm, but the Lord uses a dark place. The bad news is that God sends storms. Here's the good news. God sends a big fish, too. God might send storms, but God will send a big fish. You'll notice that in the text it says that the fish swallowed him up. And he ended up in the belly of a great fish, 3 days and three nights in a dark place. You ever spend a few days and a few nights in a dark place wondering how you ended up there? That's Jonah. Maybe you're there now. Maybe you're there now. It was R.T. Kendall, biblical scholar, who said this, quote, the belly of a fish is not a happy place to live, but it is a good place to learn. Jonah learned two things, and we're going to see him next week. Jonah learned, number one, he learned the truth about his own heart. He learned that he's a runaway. He learned that he's a sinner. Second thing Jonah learned is he learned about the heart of God. He learned that God is gracious and that God is a pursuer, not just of Jonah, but of all. 3 days, three nights. So let me ask you, where are you? Nineveh? Doing the hard thing God called you to, or Tarshish, hiding away? Because here's the truth, my friends, here's the truth. I am Jonah. I am. You are Jonah. You are. You need to be honest. We are Jonah. This is who we are. We run away. A couple of years after I began a relationship with Christ, in 1990, about 2 years later, when I came to Christ, I was a death metal drummer. I'd been involved in drugs my whole life, all that kind of stuff. And a couple of years later, I was working at this factory, and I was on my way home, and I ran into a friend, an old drug friend I hadn't seen in years. And his name was John. And I was driving home from work, and a friend of mine, I was driving him home, and he wanted me to pull over somewhere, so I pulled over. And while we were there, my friend John saw me, and he came over to the car. I hadn't seen John in a long time. John comes up to me and goes, hey, Jim, dude, where you been? What's going on? So you're a Christian, huh? I was like, yeah. Yeah, I am. He's like, wow. And I remember now, John's a drug friend. And John was like, hey, man, you remember where I live? I go, yeah, I remember where you live. I remember your basement window. He's like, yeah. He's like, maybe you should come by sometime, dude. I'm like, yeah, I'll do that. In the back of my mind, I don't want to go over there. I don't want to be around John and those dudes. I know who they are, I know what they're doing. I just don't want to deal with any of that. So I drove away. And right before I drove away, John was like, hey, dude, by the way, your hair looks awesome. Because I actually had hair, not just there. I had really, really long hair. It was down here. And so John's like, dude. I'm like, thanks, bro. So he left. Next day, I get up. I'm going to work. I work in the factory, and I had to put my hair in ties, you know, because you get in the machine and kill you. Can't do that. So I had to put it in ties. So every morning, I brush my hair, put in, like, I don't know, a bunch of ties, just so many. So I was putting him in, and as I'm putting him in, all of a sudden, John flashes in my head. Hey, dude, so you're a Christian, huh? Yeah. Remember where I live? Yeah. you should come by. Yeah, no. Went on my way. Next day, got up to go to work, was brushing my hair. As soon as I start brushing my hair, there's John again. Hey, so you're a Christian, huh? Yeah. Remember where I live? Yeah. You should come by. Yeah. No, no way. I won't deal with that. Third day, wake up, brush my hair, same story. You're a Christian, huh? Remember where I live? Come on by. Nah, ain't gonna happen. Fourth day, I get to work, standing at my machine, you know, we stretch before you get going. This girl I've known for a long time, Tammy, comes running by, just she's completely unglued, absolutely unglued. She's crying uncontrollably. Well, Tammy, what's the matter? It's like, didn't you hear? John died last night. Drove his car right into a tree. 100 miles an hour. I was like, what? All I could think of. So you're a Christian, huh? Yeah. Remember where I live? Yeah. You should come on by. Yeah. So I'm at the funeral. There's John. And all those guys I didn't want to see, there they were. And I stood there looking at John. And I remember saying to him and to God, I'm sorry. Never again. So you're a Christian, huh? Christian? Maybe you should come on by. Let's pray. God, in one little chapter, one little book, we can see your heart is so big. Big enough not just for anyone, that's good news, but big enough for everyone, even the people that we wouldn't have a heart for. God, we recognize today that you have called your people to be the vessel through whom you express your heart. And our confession today is, God, we confess and acknowledge that there is no refuge from you, but there is only refuge in you. With heads bowed and with eyes closed, as we pray today, as we respond to God's message, or some of you here today, the truth is you are a Christian. When the Spirit of God says you're a Christian, huh? Your answer in your heart is, yeah, I am. And with heads bowed and eyes closed, this is your moment to deal with God and do business with God. If you're a Christian, the truth of God is that he has called you to express his heart to the people in your life. And there's somebody here today as a Christian, the truth is you've run away. The truth is you've not done it. Truth is, you've been like Jonah in a lot of ways, where you know the words, you know the talk, you rely on all those things, but you're not doing what you should be doing. You found a ship, and you're going the other way, and there's a storm all around you, and God is trying to intervene to call you back to his heart so that you might know the joy of truly being the people of God. If you're here today and you're a Christian, your prayer is, God, I want to be what the people of God are supposed to be. I want to know your heart, I want to experience your heart, and I want to express your heart, nothing else. If that's your prayer, raise your hand right now, because I want to pray for you. God, I pray for all my friends, that you would just give us, even right now, that moment that Jonah had, sitting in the darkness of our own little spot right here, to just say, oh God, you are God, and I am not. Forgive me. For finding a ship to Tarshish and not going to Nineveh, that tough place you've called me to love and serve, to demonstrate what sin and grace look like through my life, my words, and my service of you. Oh God, may we never, ever miss your assignments, God. As we continue praying today, there's others of you here today. Truth is, you can't look to a moment when you've trusted Christ to be your Savior. He's not in your life. And as a result, you don't belong to him. But here's the truth. God has a heart for you. All of your life, wherever you've gone, whatever you've done, God has been pursuing you. He's been calling out to you. He's been reaching out to you. Maybe you find yourself in a dark place, a stormy place. Maybe you find yourself empty and alone, filled with shame. You need to understand that God sent His only Son, Jesus Christ, just for you so that you might know forgiveness, that you might know God's love, God's heart, and that you might become one of His very own. If you're here today and you are not right with God, and maybe you're ready to be, you hear the Spirit of God calling out to you right now, inviting you to step into a relationship with Christ. It begins by simply admitting that you've run away. Getting right with God is as simple as A, B, C. A, admit you're a runaway. You're a sinner and you need a Savior. And B, to believe on Jesus, that God sent Jesus Christ to die on the cross to pay for your sins and to rise from the grave to offer you new life. And then C, to call upon Him. Scripture says, whoever calls upon Him, calls upon Jesus, will be saved. That means forgiven. That means God's Spirit will come into your life. That means He'll begin right here, right now, the moment you call upon Him, to begin to make you the person you were meant to be. If your prayer is, Christ, I need you. I want you. I'm opening my life up to you. I'm calling upon you now. Jesus, save me. Jesus, forgive me. Jesus, come into my life. If that's your prayer, just lift your hand right now. People, wherever you are, just lift your hand right up. So that's me. Christ, come into my life. Christ, I need you. Christ, I want you. Those of you in the loft, if that's your prayer, just don't hold back and lift your hand. Those of you in this room, those of you online, sitting wherever you are, just acknowledge that before God. God, I need you. And we can just call upon Jesus together in the quiet of your own heart. You can just pray and say, dear God, I am a sinner and I need a Savior. And Jesus, I believe that you are the Son of God, that you died for my sins, that you rose from the grave. And right now I'm asking you to forgive all of my sins, to come into my life, to fill me with your Spirit, and to make me new. Thank you for forgiveness, and thank you for new life. For it's in Jesus' name that I pray. And everyone said, amen. Let's celebrate together, Colonial Church.